So here we are sitting in a computer.
Yes.
I'm sorry, this is what came out of the R1? Wait, this?
We actually saved 1.6 miles of wiring.
I love the way this feels. I don't think I've ever felt a haptic wheel be this intuitive.
You've tricked me into being environmentally conscious by just being a very good car. I'm Mohak, and I'm here to see how Rivian is built different.
Hi, how you doing?
Hey, super excited to be here. I'm a Rivian owner myself, have an R1S. One of the things I love most about my Rivian is that it feels like this extremely technologically advanced machine. Like, it's crazy fast. It's super powerful. It's an electric car. It's got amazing software, but it feels emotionally resonant in a very human way. Like, I connect with it. Tell me a bit about kind of how you think about design when it comes to the car.
And one of the balances that we really push for at Rivian is how do you create something that looks very distinct, feels premium, and also simple. And doing something that's simple was one of the hardest things to do, because the more things you take away, it's harder to introduce personality. So it's really finding that fine line. And I think the vehicle is a perfect example of how we've been able to achieve that. You look at the overall shape of the vehicle, the silhouette, it's very simple. The line work's very simple.
I could draw this vehicle.
Yes.
And I can't draw anything.
Well, that's one of the things that I absolutely love to say is, like, if you look at any good design, turn your face and walk away and still remember it, then you've come on to something.
I love that. All right, well, let's actually go look at this vehicle then.
So these are different stages of how we use properties within our studio. You know, you have finished cars, which are full-on prototypes. We've got our clay models there. We wrap it to make it look like it's a real vehicle, even though it's clay underneath of it. And then these are like quick little mock-ups that we'll do where we can get a spatial experience of the car done with a light density foam. So we use these different types of models as we're going on to make sure we're making informed decisions that can actually prevent us from doing costly changes later.
It feels so decidedly low tech to build a car body out of clay.
Yeah.
You've got VR.
Yeah.
You've got like 3D printing. Why this approach?
To me, there's no replacement for being able to like see the vehicle in the flesh and touch it. It's actually faster for us.
It's faster to the end state.
Yes, because once it's modeled in the clay, you know it looks good. It's how we've been able to make something simpler still feel very premium is one of the biggest challenges we've had. My ask always is, like, if someone can take that piece out and you won't miss that it's there,
then
it shouldn't be there.
Then don't include
it. If you try to remove this piece of wood, the screen's literally got nothing to sit on.
Wow. What was important for you to keep?
The flashlight in the door. That was something that we debated quite a lot. It's just a Rivian thing, and those features are what really differentiate us. Another area I'm really excited about is what we've done with these steering wheel controls.
Can I get in?
Yeah, go ahead. Right. I'll go through the menu now, scroll up and down. Press it in.
Oh, I love the way this feels. So that clicking, that's haptics.
That's haptics, yeah.
That's amazing. That's creating friction.
Yep.
That's remarkable. I don't think I've ever felt a haptic wheel be this intuitive.
The math and the engineering behind this is very complex, but the user experience wants to be really simple and intuitive.
Wow. That's cool.
There's inherent cost in engineering in the scroll wheels, but it's less money than having these dials and buttons and everything everywhere. But it provides you that opportunity to improve the user experience in a way that's unique. Taking cost out doesn't mean you have to reduce functionality.
The simplification led to enhanced functionality.
Yeah.
So something you said that was interesting to me. As an engineer, I think about like all the great designers I've worked with. And often it feels like there's like a conflict, that there's friction between design and engineering.
Yeah. And there should always exist. There's a healthy conflict.
How does that play out here? Something like this has to be a collaborative process.
Yep. I have our engineers come into the studio as often as possible so they can understand the trade-offs that are being made. There is a lot of push and pull between the teams where we don't always agree.
What I like about that is you're essentially saying that there isn't a natural point of handoff in the process. The design team and the engineering team are essentially co-designing this vehicle, every aspect of it together from the beginning, which is really powerful. All right, this is cool. So here we are sitting in a computer.
Yes, literally sitting in a computer
sitting
on frames,
computer.
Yes. This is a lab car. It has all the electronics that you have in a vehicle, but it's just exposed. So it helps us test it more easily and debug things. any sort of signal integrity effects that you see in a real vehicle, you'll see right here.
We spoke to the design lab. How do you collaborate with that lab? How do you think about where you come in to that
process? Absolutely. We don't have a clean sheet of paper, as in the car is not built for us.
Right.
That's really built for the occupant. So you look at the aesthetics, what should the car look like? That's a very design studio piece. Once that's all done, you have a frame, mm-hmm. and your job is to fit in there.
And so you have to negotiate the shape of this curve.
That's right.
Wow.
Or shape of something there, or maybe even a part. And it's always very, very important from aerodynamics point of view. You'd be surprised the amount of time we spend negotiating for space.
What does that process look like?
Everybody's trying to optimize for their solution. In the end, we end up with something that works best for the overall product, right? Yeah. So this was the very first vehicle we ever built.
Yep.
The R1 Gen 1. You have a controller per function. So like one to do body controls, one to do thermal management, one for dynamics. But we know we can do better. What we did is switch to what we call Gen 2 platform, where we actually consolidated a lot of the
controllers. You learned a bunch here.
We learned a bunch, yeah.
Let's simplify.
That's right. We had 17 unique controllers here.
Uh-huh.
We went down to 7 on that one. Instead of having function-based controls, we now have geography-based controls. We actually saved 1.6 miles of wiring by doing this.
From this car to
this car? Yes.
1.6 miles,
of wiring. Wiring, 44 pounds. At the end of the day, it reduces mass, and mass helps range, right?
The more weight you can take out, ultimately, the more range you can pull out of it,
which
is a really important thing.
That's right. Yeah. This is that big harness that doesn't exist anymore.
I'm sorry, this is what came out of the R1?
Yeah. Just try lifting it.
Wait, this?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
What a unique thing to say that you're actually reducing cost. You've got less parts.
Exactly, yeah.
Are there trade-offs?
The trade-off is in manufacturing complexity. It actually becomes harder to install at the factory. So we have best practices. For example, you don't try to put a connection in the middle of the vehicle, because if you think about an operator, they're working from one side or the other, and for them to reach over all the way to the middle is hard.
I love the fact that, you know, normally when you talk about human-centric design, you're talking about your customers.
Right.
You're talking about human-centric design by like thinking about your employees.
You have to, right? Because it's really, they're doing this every day.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
After you.
All right.
This is our color materials room. Where do we draw inspiration from? We often have a lot of different artifacts to be inspired by, whether that's certain shoes or backpacks.
Something I noticed is it feels like there's an inherent undercurrent of like meaningful design. Is that accurate?
We'd like to as much as we can. There's some things we do, I'm not gonna lie and say we don't do some things just because we think they look cool. There's always a balance of that. We try to start with this idea of it being simplistic in terms of its approach, in terms of how you use it, in terms of the way it looks. But then as you get into the vehicle and you know more about it, then you start to realize all these little details. And it is difficult, because as you add functionality, you are adding more complication. So that's something that we have to constantly balance between.
How do you decide when you add functionality?
I would say our vehicle is probably one of the most feature-rich vehicles. That's where we try to find little moments of joy, like our little interactions with GearGuard. If you see GearGuard within our UI, tap him and something will happen. We want these little Easter eggs, these little moments of joyful utility, we like to call them, to not take ourselves too seriously.
I'm not an EV enthusiast. I just wanted a big car to haul my family. But the car won me over by just being better. You've tricked me into being environmentally conscious by buying this electric car that is good for the environment by also just being a very good car. Has that been a conscious thought that like we're gonna build something better?
Yeah, I mean, how can we make the biggest impact? It's like go after a segment that's large in volume and large in terms of being inefficient. RJ says this often, we're working towards something that is sustainable for our kids. We're trying to use recycled materials or content to make the vehicles themselves more sustainable. But I also truly believe if we're gonna use the sustainable materials, the customer shouldn't be punished for it or see that. I think inherently as humans, we all wanna make the right choice for the environment. It's our job to make it easy for them.
I love that. When you eliminate all the inconveniences, when you build something that's beautiful, when you build something that works, like making the environmentally conscious choices easy. One of my first experiences driving my own Rivian was that it felt like a car that had just been designed with love. What's really remarkable is that that is actually a core philosophy of the design process. It is as much a computer as it is a truck, as it is an electric car. The infusion of love with something that is technologically forward, with something that is ecologically conscious, with something that is extremely practical, really does feel built different.